Guys, it is our pleasure to be joined by Andy Grammer. Hello.
So good to be here.
Welcome to Australia.
How are you?
I'm very well, and I'm very glad to see that you actually decided to bring your show back into our country.
Yes.
First impressions of Australia.
Well, I've been here a bunch. It's one of my favorite places in the world.
Yeah?
I'm not
second
just saying
home?
That. It's lovely, and everybody's always so good to me here. And yeah, I'm so psyched to be here actually with my band. I've been here a bunch doing like solo stuff, opening up for other bands, doing TV shows with kind of by myself. But, you know, we were just in contact with the rest of my guys and we're going to throw some parties.
It's so what is it like having the guys with you as opposed to doing it with yourself and, I guess, session musos?
So it's just a smaller version of what we like to do. Like when we play shows throughout the year, like a ton of shows, and we have our way of being together. I'm a solo artist, but my band is like pretty important to me. They're all really close. A lot of them have been with me for like 8 to 9 years.
Yeah.
So it's like, it's a whole thing.
It's your family.
It's my family, yeah.
And you have just released your new single, Give Love. You're working on a new album, but that all began with busking. It feels like forever ago, probably.
Long time ago, yeah.
Why did you originally start busking?
It's just kind of freedom of speech. Like, you're not allowed to tell me to stop.
Yeah.
When you're trying to get into clubs and nobody will book you, then it's a really still a good way to just kind of practice and get a lot of feedback from people as they're walking by, whether they like what you're doing or not.
Yeah, and the hard thing is getting them to actually stop, I guess.
It's hard.
How did you make them listen and feel like what you were doing was important?
Yeah, I think that, you know, like, development as an artist is like people have different ways of developing and trying stuff out and getting information back. And for me, the street was a wonderful way to do that. Play a song, people don't stop. Play another song, people don't stop. Play a third song, and they like that one for some reason. So you keep that one. It's like very basic.
Yeah.
But just a lot of energy and time put into like getting better on the street.
What were the best tactics for you, do you think?
Well, there's like gimmicks, right?
Yep.
You might be able to get someone's attention with a gimmick, but the only way that they're gonna pull $10 out of their pocket and buy your CD is if you get them in their heart with a good song.
Yeah.
So there's like lots of little tactics, like if you're lucky enough to get 5 or 10 people around, you say, okay, I'm gonna play one chord and you're all gonna scream your faces off.
Yeah.
And then you do that and then everybody kind of looks over and then you just, you know, you build up a crowd.
Yeah.
There's a lot of like, again, like little gimmicks to make a crowd bigger. But at the end of the day, once you have a crowd, if you don't play something that moves them, they'll all just leave.
Do you look back on it fondly and have good memories of that season?
Yes. Oh, I love it. But I do go back sometimes to the street and I'm like glad that I don't do it anymore.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it was a really great place to get started.
And you mentioned that ability to connect people and actually move their heart with your music. That's one of the things I think is really obvious in your lyrics and in what you share.
You.
How have you found a way to actually draw people in and connect to their hearts in music?
I think that it's my main goal in songwriting is to try and write proofs, like life proofs. Like scientifically, that people like publish papers and they try to write out something that hasn't been written yet that we all go through.
Yeah.
Right? And so when you write it down and then you give it to everybody else and they go like, oh yeah, totally. This happens to me all the time. And you actually wrote out what it was.
Yeah.
I think that a great song has that in it.
Yeah. And one of the biggest songs you've written was, of course, Keep Your Head Up. That got everybody going. Yep. I love seeing it in Pitch Perfect. Congratulations for that. That song has such fun and such joy in it. What was the story behind that?
That was just, you know, my mom passed away when I was 25 and I was street performing and very poor, not a lot of prospects. And that came after a long day of just not making any money on the street.
Yeah, wow.
So you're just kind of like, am I crazy right now? Because my other friends have real jobs and I'm a street performer, like which sometimes gets confused with homelessness. It's not, I wasn't homeless, but I'm out there and I'm just doing my thing and I'm getting no validation from any direction.
Yep.
So I kind of wrote that song for myself.
Did you feel like it made a difference to your feeling of validation?
Didn't make me feel more validated, but I think that there's a place in everybody's mind that you can go to that against all odds, it will still work.
Yeah.
Like I have a lot of stressful things going on in my life, but where I rest and where I end is like, I know that it's going to work out.
Yeah.
And I have to tell myself that a lot, even when it's hard to believe that. So I think that Keep Your Head Up did that for me when I wrote it from a place of like, no matter what, it's going to work. And and then when people heard it, I think it gave them that same thing.
Yeah.
And so that's why I think it connected to me.
Listeners and your fans, because particularly in songs like Holding Out or Holding On, those sorts of songs, the lyrics are just so honest. You share a lot about what you went through, waiting for love and all of the temptations that can come with that. What motivates you to be so honest about your life experience?
I think that when you are operating in a space that could be considered positive, that word is the worst. And I don't know, I wish there was a better word. When you're operating in a space that is uplifting or honest, not honest, uplifting or positive,
yeah.
The way that it gets so cheesy so fast is when you're not brutally honest.
Yeah.
We all have different spectrums to ourselves, and it's just cooler, inherently cooler, if you play a minor chord and talk about your sorrows. You are inherently cooler, I don't know why, right off the bat.
Yep.
If you play a major chord and you sing about things that are going well, it's inherently cheesier. It happens immediately.
Mm.
And the only thing that I can find that makes operating in those spaces and writing songs in spaces not cheesy is when I'm just brutally honest about the whole situation. And I also think that when you share sincerely of the full spectrum of yourself, then people trust you. You know, a song like Keep Your Head Up, if I was just singing that just because, I don't know, I just kind of had a bad day.
Yeah.
I think that the listener could kind of tell. I know that's like seems a little bit airy-fairy, but when you hear me sing it, it's like, I'm not saying these words directly, but like, I just lost my mom, which is terrible. I have no money. I'm really going through it right now.
Yeah.
And I'm still going to write a song that says, you got to keep your head up. And now that I want to hear.
Yeah.
I don't want to hear just like, everything's cool because, like for no reason, you know? So I think that honesty in my line of work is the only chance I have. But you got to keep your head up. Oh, oh.